Hey, good afternoon, folks, and welcome to our Rail Facts Live. This is the second time that we've had a chance to come to you on Facebook Live. We have a treat for you today because, as you may be able to notice, we are on one of the trains. I want to introduce our executive director and chief executive officer for the Honolulu Authority for Rapid Transportation. This is Andrew Robbins. Andy, good afternoon to you.
Good afternoon. I'm going to take the mask off so
go ahead.
Can hear
I'll
me.
Keep mine on. I tell you what, we're on the train. Tell me what makes this train not unique, but certainly stands apart when it comes to U.S. mass transportation, does it not?
Yes, it does. This is actually going to be the first totally driverless rail system of in a cross-urban situation in an American city. So we're very excited to be introducing this in a major urban environment.
What are some of the benefits of having a driverless system? And we talked about this seat is going to be very popular once interim service starts up, because you're going to feel like you're driving the train.
Well, one of the things I love with driverless trains is that people, and especially children, can come right up to the front window. There's no compartment for the operator here that kind of blocks your view. So it's really exciting. In other driverless systems that I've been around in other parts of the world, children just migrate right up to the front. They'd love to have this seat and pretend like they're driving, and it's really a cool sight for, you know, all the engineers that really made this happen to see the enjoyment.
One of the questions that you get often whenever we've had community meetings, is it safe having a driverless system, and if so, why?
Yeah, so where we are with the technology in the 21st century is that it's actually safer now to have driverless technology. The computer systems and the technology is at such a point where the safety level is so high that it sort of overcomes the human factor element, because all of us humans are fallible in some way. So we remove the human element from actually driving the train, and it's actually safer these days to have a driverless train. But we still have plenty of human beings involved in the operations and maintenance of the system. And that's actually another major benefit of the driverless technology, is that we don't need to lock someone up in the front anymore. We can redeploy those people to be more customer service agents, mingle with passengers, provide wayfinding, other information, and really just to be the eyes and ears. They'll be carrying walkie-talkies. They'll be able to observe what's going on with the system, check things like safety and security. So it's really a benefit from that standpoint as well.
And Andy, when you have an automated system, that also makes it, if you and I are passengers and we're standing at one of the 21 stops that are going to be available, it makes it easier and quicker, does it not, as far as getting trains in and out of stations?
Right. So, well, the whole system is regulated by the technology now. So in terms of the trip times, you know, when we build out the system all the way to Ala Moana Boulevard, Ala Moana Station, it'll be 5 minutes headway or 5 minutes between trains during the peak period. And the computer system will regulate that so that you don't get bunching, which sometimes you get when you have buses that are driven, get stuck in traffic. The system will regulate it, it'll keep the trains spaced apart, and it'll make the service very reliable. So end to end, we're talking about from the East Kapolei location to Ala Moana, 42 minutes, and that would be every day, you know, regardless of what the traffic conditions are.
It makes a big difference for people going to work, because that's something you can count on every day. And we talked about how fast will the trains go, because you talked about the buses. Yeah. And I know that your Wes Freistacke, the director of Department of Transportation Services, is on the board of directors. Buses don't move very quickly, do they not, as far as when they're in traffic? Their average speed is only 10, 11 miles an hour?
It's something around that, it's about 10 miles an hour, because
the
buses are in traffic like everybody else. Now, there are techniques in terms of special bus lanes, and we have some, Hotel Street, for example. And, you know, we have a great bus system here in Honolulu. We're very fortunate. But yes, because it's on the road, and it's really meant more for local circulation, the average speed is somewhere around 10 miles an hour. And the director has told me it's gotten worse over the years as the traffic has gotten worse. So what we're doing with the rail system is we're building what we call in the industry grade separated guideway. So it's not mixed in with traffic, there's no crossings, it's on a dedicated right-of-way, dedicated guideway. and therefore it's just reserved for the trains, and they're regulated, as I mentioned, so that way we can deliver very predictable service.
It's going to be wonderful, and I'm telling you, the first time you pass over the H1 freeway and you see a major accident down below, you're going to be thankful that you're on this elevated guideway.
Right.
This system, we talked about the safety of it. How many trains are we going to have when this is fully operational? And what makes up a train? How many cars?
Right. So we're buying 24 car trains.
Okay.
Okay. So each train will have four individual train cars that are coupled together permanently in our case. And it's about 250 feet long, four car train. We're buying 20 of those.
Okay.
And when we have a full build out to Ala Moana, we'll have 17 in service during the peak period
rush
of the
hour,
day.
Afternoon rush hour.
Right. So that's very good utilization of the fleet to use 17 trains out of 20. When we open up the first segment, the first 10 miles from East Kapolei to Aloha Stadium, we'll have seven trains available. And the city's plan is to have 10 minutes between trains for that introductory service.
Okay. Well, we're going to give you a tour in just a minute or so. But before we do that, I forgot to remind you out there in Facebook land, if you have questions for Executive Director Robbins, our CEO, please send them in. And as soon as we get on taking the tour, we'll get a chance to answer some of those questions, if you don't mind.
Not at all.
Okay. So if we will, do you want to take that tour right now? Just to kind
sure.
of see. You talked about how this is going to be utilized. And I think when we get a chance to see this, you'll see that everyone's going to be able to use this. We're talking about from Keiki all the way to our Kupuna, correct?
Right. It's for everyone. And, you know, when you experience rail transit in other cities, for example, I lived in Hong Kong.
Okay.
Everyone uses it because it's very reliable, it's fast, and convenient.
Okay. Yeah. So the very first thing we want to show you is unique to Hawaii, because what is this, if you don't mind me asking?
Well, it looks like a surfboard to me. And I would say it's unique to North America for sure. It's probably one of the few rail systems in the world. We believe there's one in Australia that allows surfboards, but definitely a first in North America, where you can bring surfboards on board the train. And we have dedicated racks designed
to
take surfboards.
I didn't officially measure it, but about 10 feet. So you could bring kind of a bigger surfboard.
Pretty good one.
Also wanted to tell folks, when they're on the train, there is free Wi-Fi as well. So that's going to be extremely useful.
Right.
Because if you were to ride from end to end for 42 minutes, you could get a chance to do work, homework, to catch up on the emails, everything.
Absolutely. We understood, I think, from the beginning that, you know, we want to make people's journey not only comfortable, convenient, but productive. And that's one of the great benefits of riding public transportation, and especially a rail system. You know, in my day, you read a newspaper, you had the tabloid newspapers. Now it's iPads, tablets.
You're flipping through pages in a different way now.
Right.
Okay, one of the great things also is, and let me sort of demonstrate this, is you're going to be able to bring luggage on, because one of the stops, if I'm not mistaken, is at the Daniel K. Inouye International Airport.
That's right. We have a station right at the airport. So we do welcome luggage on board the trains. And what the city has said, Department of Transportation Services, is that once the rail goes into service, they're going to look at changing the rules on the bus as well, because they understand that people will be moving between bus and rail, and they need the ability to get to the airport
and
with luggage.
That's exactly what's going to happen. And like you said, it makes it a lot easier, because then you don't have to call on a friend, don't have to have family go out of their way to try to drop you off. You just simply hop on the train and you're there. Okay, ADA accessible. That's important. It's the law, but folks are going to be able to bring wheelchairs on.
Absolutely, and one of the great features of rail transit, I don't know if you can get a shot, but we have level boarding. So when you come up to the platform, you enter the station, you can, if you're in a wheelchair or you have other disabilities, you can take an elevator up to the platform and to board the train. It's level. So you come right on board with your wheelchair, and we have these locations throughout the train where you can just position a wheelchair. Perpendicular would be best. You put the wheel locks on, you're good to go. You don't need any straps, anything like that. It's very easy to use.
And I know a few months ago, not far from here, Leeward Community College, we had a train day, and it was important that we had members of the community who are in wheelchairs get a chance to see exactly what the train was like, to roll onto it, to see what it was like to access it. That was important. That was critical.
That was very important. We invited members of the disabled community to come on out to train day and come on board the trains and experience it and give us feedback. And that was very valuable as well, to hear their feedback even before we start regular passenger service.
Okay, so one of the great things also is these trains are going to be bicycle friendly, because like you said, living in Hong Kong, it's critical to unite all of this sort of transportation together, is it not?
Absolutely. What we're trying to create, working together with the city, is a multimodal public transport system. So the bus, the rail, but very importantly, walking and biking. We now have a fabulous bike system in many parts of the city, and we want to encourage people to ride bikes and access the rail system. So you can bring your bike on board. We have specialized racks, which perhaps we can show you in a moment.
Sure.
I'm sure there will be rules developed by the city in terms of
being able to stand
how to behave when you bring a bike on, where to put it, and those kind of things. But we definitely want to encourage people to connect to and from the rail with bicycles.
Awesome. Okay, we keep walking down this thing. And one of the great things also is, with all the stops that we're going to have, one of the stops is going to be, well, before we get to that, the other part of this is, besides the ADA accessibility, you also want to make this accessible for young families. So moms and dads who maybe have a child in a stroller,
right.
Those are going to be easy enough. And once again, you talked about that level boarding. It's
right.
Going to be easy to get them in and out.
Right. And I go back to my Hong Kong experience. It wasn't all ADA there. A lot of stairs. If you're familiar with Hong Kong, we used to carry the strollers up and down. Here in Honolulu, we have accessibility. We follow ADA. So we want to make sure that's extended to the rail system as well. So the same level boarding that we talked about with the wheelchairs is, of course, available for strollers as well. You bring them right on board. Again, there's special locations, or you can position in front of your seat, put the wheel locks on, and you're good to go.
And one of the other things is, there are 21 stops when this is fully built out. One of the stops is Aloha Stadium. There are football games, concerts, different things like that. The possibility of maybe even tailgating. You can bring coolers on board.
You can bring coolers as well.
Right.
So, and then you see the fold-up seats. So, you know, you talked about Aloha Stadium.
Yeah.
Certainly before the coronavirus days, you know, you get a big crowd. I'm sure it's going to come back eventually. You can fold these seats up and more people can fit onto the trains. Yeah.
Okay. And then I wanted to show, you talked about safety. I want to show the distance of the train.
Yeah.
How big is the train and what makes this so unusual? Because there's no door here.
Yeah. That's a great point, Jai. As I mentioned earlier, it's a four-car train, about 250 feet long. And if you're familiar with the New York subway or the BART system, you know that there are these doors in between the train cars. And really, it's for emergency use mostly. Other people do use them occasionally on those systems. They're not easy to use.
Yeah.
You're walking between the trains. What you see in other parts of the world, not so much here in America, is these wide open gangways, as we call them. So we're really excited to be able to introduce this feature to Hawaii and to the United States as well. And it just creates this complete open feeling between all the train doors. It complements the wide open windows. The atmosphere here is just open, airy, and I think the gangways certainly contribute to that. And if you can't find a seat on one car, you can easily move to another car. If you're in sense of safety and security, you can just move among all the cars in a train.
Director, if you don't mind, so the other thing too is, when we've had these talks before, one of the things you make mention of is safety. If a system's not safe, then it's not gonna work. So I want you to talk about what you see here, what we see here, and even what we see here.
Okay, sure. Well, I like to talk about clean, safe, reliable. These are the three most important things to really attract ridership and to welcome people and get the choice riders, you know, not just people who depend on public transportation, but on a weekend or an evening, you know, you want to go out, choose public transportation, choose rail. So that's what we're trying to accomplish here. We're working very hard together with the city to achieve those goals of clean, safe, reliable. So what you see here, first of all, this is an information sign. It'll be a digital dynamic information sign that will tell you what the next stop is, what the next station is that's coming, hold on, those kind of messages. And then we have real-time onboard closed-circuit television. So back in our control center, we have operators that will be able to see what's going on in each and every one of the cars and trains on the system. So that really enhances onboard safety as well, that will be monitored in real time, all the time.
And the other thing, if you and I are riding and someone has sort of a medical emergency or something to that effect, you've got call boxes as well.
Right, so I mentioned the control center, which is staffed 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. We have these emergency call buttons. You push the button, you can contact somebody back in the control center and get any kind of assistance that you need.
Well, the great thing too is when we talk about the safety, you're only at most 3 or 4 minutes between stations. Right. So when you do say there's a medical emergency, they can get an ambulance to sort of be waiting for you at the next stop.
That's right. And I mentioned earlier that we have personnel that will be deployed all around the system, moving among the trains, in the trains, various stations. There'll be a dedicated security workforce as well, that's in uniform and sometimes not in uniform. Mm-hmm. So there will be workers, employees all around the system, you know, and can respond to any kind of call like that. Yeah.
So, okay, we're gonna keep moving. And the great thing is Facebook Live, if you folks are out there, if you do have a question for Director Robbins, in just a few minutes, we're gonna get to some of those questions. And so we just wanted to show you one of the trains because as he said, once this is fully built out, we're talking 20 trains that are going to make up the fleet.
Correct. Yeah, let's go look at a bicycle rack. Yeah.
Okay, that's important because you had made mention earlier. So here's this is one of the actual racks. So when you do come on, you get a chance to hook the bike up if you need it too. So that's the important thing. Like you had said, it's mass transportation is not just about the train. It's about the bus. It's about walking. It's about biking. Multiple people.
Exactly, and we're going to have the holo card, the smart card that allows you to move between the bus and the rail, and probably one day the Beaky will be connected into the holo card as well.
It makes it super convenient where you literally can, because like you had said, when we've talked with Director Freistacki before with Department of Transportation Services, the bus and the train are really going to need to work together.
Absolutely.
They're partners. They're not against each other. They're partners in this whole thing.
Yeah, it's different pieces in the puzzle to provide efficient public transportation.
Yeah. Again, if you are on Facebook catching us live with Rail Facts, this is our second time that we've had. The first time, Director Robbins got the chance to join us at our business outreach center over in Kalihi. This time we're actually on one of the trains. And I don't know about you, but I've seen these trains testing either in the daytime or at night.
Right.
Does it excite you as a lifelong mass transit sort of guy?
Totally exciting. That's what it's all about, is to get it up and running and get passengers on board. So.
Yeah.
I can tell you everybody at heart in the city is working extremely hard to make that come true.
And it is. So we'll go back up to the front, and then if you don't mind, we'll get some questions and we can have folks answer. Obviously, I don't think we're the only ones that are excited when they see, because we have actually seen some of folks have sent us pictures, have sent us videos of the train being tested. So we're not alone. There are others who are excited about it as well.
Yeah.
Okay, so Facebook Live, if you have a question, go ahead and send that in to us, and we get a chance to ask Director Robbins, and we appreciate any question.
Brand new train, so it's probably a recent arrival from the factory, so some of the plastic is there to protect the seat cushions, we're going through an extensive test period, so we want to keep everything clean and as new as possible.
Well, and that's the other thing too, is with the testing, there's an important aspect to that because it has to be certified. You don't just simply put them on the track and they're ready to go. There's an extensive process that goes into getting them
absolutely
certified.
So for several years people are familiar with all the construction activities associated with this project. That's what you've read about, what you see on the television news, the ups and downs of all the construction activities. But we're now at the point where the technology is here, the trains, the automatic control systems, communications, the technology part of the railroad.
Yeah.
And all of that has to be tested individually and then together so that it all works as an integrated system. So it's a very extensive test program. And we have a lot of people from Hitachi Rail, from HART, from other entities that are all coming together, going through all that testing that culminates in what we call trial running, which is running the entire system as if it were running normally, but not with passengers. That's sort of the final big test.
Yep.
And then we work together with the Hawaii Department of Transportation to get the entire system certified from a safety standpoint. Okay. And it's only at that point can the system be ready to open for passengers.
So we have a question from Marissa asking if there will be security guards on board.
Okay, very good question. And then I know earlier you had said clean, safe, reliable.
Yeah.
What's safe? And will there be a security force? How will you make sure that people are safe on the train?
Yeah, so there's multiple levels of safety that are being designed into the system. The first one is that technology component. We showed you one of the cameras. We showed you call buttons. Those are all part of the technology part of safety and security. But there's a human component as well. And I mentioned that the first level are what we call the roving personnel. Again, we don't need people to drive the train, so we can redeploy them. They carry walkie-talkies. They're the eyes and ears of the system. And they also have some technical capability to take care of any matter that comes up. That's sort of the first level. And then we have a private security workforce, if you will, that'll be dedicated to the rail system. So they'll be in uniform and also out of uniform, moving among the trains, moving around the various stations. Okay. So there'll be a certain staff on every shift of every day, just moving around the entire system, looking after safety issues, and enforcing what we call the code of conduct. So there will be a sort of the rules of using the rail system that the city is developing. No eating, no drinking, no smoking, but also things like maximum time to ride the system.
Yeah.
You know, it's only 42 minutes from one end to the other. So you're expected to get on board the system, go to your destination, and eventually depart the system.
Yeah.
So they'll be enforcing that as well. Okay. And then the third level of security, if you will, is HPD.
Yeah.
HPD will always be available for emergencies that require police officers.
Well, yeah. Marissa, Facebook, out there in Facebook land, thank you, Marissa, for that question.
Thank you.
Our next question, if you don't mind, Director Robin.
This question is from Buffy. They're asking how much it will cost to park at the park and rides.
Oh, okay, so Buffy, ask us out there, park and rides. So there's going to be four dedicated park and rides. How much will it cost to park there?
Okay, well, that is a matter for that's being looked at by the Rate Commission.
Okay.
The city organized a rate commission to look into all these matters of how much the fare would be to use the rail system. Also looking again at the bus fares, as well as things like the park and ride. So my understanding is that the Rate Commission has now made a formal recommendation to the city. It goes to the Department of Transportation Services, to the mayor, and then it'll be up to the city council to decide what the fare structure will be, and that would include whether there's going to be a cost at the park and rides as well. So I don't have that answer right now, but that all will be determined in very soon.
So the 26 years I spent in front of a camera for a television station, they call that a tease. So stay tuned. Stay tuned and we'll find out about that. Okay, yeah. Another question from all our folks out there in Facebook land.
Alexander is asking how many miles of track in the first segment?
Okay. Alexander asks, interim service, what does that entail? From East Kapolei to where?
East Kapolei to Aloha Stadium.
Okay.
And it's about 10 miles, but it's a double track system. So you asked how much track?
It's a math question. It's
yeah, it's more of a math question. So it's 20 miles on the main line.
Okay.
And then we have all this track work here in the yard as well. This is where we store the trains and clean the trains, dispatch the trains. So there's a lot of track work here, probably another 5 miles of track just in this location. But I think the question really was, what's the distance between East Kapolei and Aloha Stadium
sure.
for the initial introductory service?
Yep.
And that's a 10-mile stretch.
And that's basically, that's going to be half the line, because once it's
right.
fully operational, we're talking 20 miles.
We're talking 20 miles, 21 stations for the
okay.
full line. Yeah.
Thank you very much for that question. Another Facebook question.
We had a question that came through email asking about the hand straps.
Oh, okay. So email, folks wanted to know, the wonderful thing about this is, everything kind of has meaning to it, does
yeah.
it not?
Yeah, so what you're seeing here are the grab bars, if you will.
Okay.
So these are located on the ceiling. We also have them along the walls here and on the seats. There will be hand straps installed as well. They're just not installed yet.
It's a brand new train.
Yep. Right. So what we're looking at is on a four-car train, we have 188 seats, and we can have people standing, about 400 more people standing.
Okay.
So if, again, safety being a prime consideration, we want to have always available for people standing, either a grab bar or a hand strap.
Okay. So those hand straps are to be installed. Mm-hmm. Like we said, it's a brand new train, so it's got to get everything, all the bells and whistles put on it.
Correct.
Okay. Another question. If you do have a question, you're watching us right now on Facebook Live, quickly send it in, and we can get Director Robbins to answer any questions you have.
Alexander would like to know how fast the trains go. The slowest, the fastest, and the average.
Okay. All right. Let's ask Director Robbins. How fast? Hey, let's wind it out. Let's see what it can do. What's this baby got in it?
That's a great question. So the trains are actually designed for 65 miles an hour.
Okay.
But we're going to have a top speed on this system of 55 miles an hour. And I mentioned it's a 20-mile, 21-station system. So we have a station about every mile. So 55 miles an hour is really all we need as a top speed.
Okay.
Now, if you factor in all the stops and starts among those 21 stations, the average speed, including all the stops and starts, is about 30 miles an hour. But as we talked about earlier, the average speed on the bus being stuck in regular traffic is about 10 miles an hour. So we're looking at three times the average speed with rail, and that makes a big difference in terms of the capacity of passengers that we can move.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you. That was a great question.
Email question.
Okay.
Can you talk about the Hawaiian station names for each of your stations, which are pretty cool?
Okay. We have another email question in talking about each station has a unique story to tell, and that was important when we were designing. Well, I shouldn't say we, but when they designed the system, that's important.
Right. So one of the things that HART did quite early on is organize a committee of Hawaiian culture practitioners and language practitioners, and formed a committee to come up with these unique Hawaiian station names. And what the names are driving to do is to tell the story of the location of where these stations are. So it's going to be, I think, a terrific history lesson, if you will, of our host culture and of this island. So, as an example, the station at Leeward Community College is called the Haulalani Station, which gives you information about that particular location. The Aloha Stadium is the Halawa Station. So, same thing.
Well, and the great thing is it's not just the name, but there's also artwork at each station that's unique to that station.
Right. So that's a whole nother level of culture, is that there will be unique art that's been commissioned for each and every station that, again, tells a story. And we're going to have placards at the stations and educational information systems available. There's even going to be an app that you can put on your smartphone. So as you're riding on the system, it will automatically pull up interesting historical information as you're moving among the stations.
That's good stuff. Appreciate that emailed in question.
Email question from Mary, and her question is, there's these big yellow contraptions by the airport, and they look like they have big cement blocks on them. Can you talk about them?
If you drive by the airport, it's kind of, you can't really miss them. They're pretty large pieces of equipment. What exactly are those, and what are they doing?
Right, so the big yellow contraptions are, you can think of them as horizontal cranes. We call them launching gantries.
Okay.
So the elevated guideway or trackway for this system is really made up of individual segments that are cast off-site. They're cast at the Campbell Industrial Yard in a casting facility. And they're about, I think they're about 10-foot wide wedges that are trucked in at night. They're positioned in place. And that big yellow launching gantry hoists them up and kind of strings those pieces together. It's called segmental bridge construction. It's been around for quite some time now, and it's a really nifty way to build an elevated structure like the rail structure. It's fast, it's reliable, and it also allows traffic to continue underneath, because if we used a more conventional construction technique, we'd have a lot more cranes and trucks and all kinds of equipment blocking the road. So for all those reasons, it's a terrific construction technique. It was used on the H3 as well. back in those days.
And I know our construction outreach, I would be remiss if I didn't say, they say look ahead, not overhead. So just know when you're driving in the area,
right.
it's wonderful, but be safe and make sure you keep your eyes on the road.
Right, go to our website. I think we have really terrific photos of that whole operation.
Okay, yeah. We got another question.
Okay, we have a very avid viewer, Kelly, that she's been watching this whole time, and she wants to know, once the stations are done and once the system's complete, can we add more in the future?
Okay, Kelly, very good question. So we've already talked about when this system's fully operational, it's 20 miles, 21 stations. Could it be expanded upon?
Absolutely. So, and that when you see rail in other cities, I think almost universally those initial systems are expanded. And that is the plan here as well. So what we are constructing, the 20-mile system from East Kapolei to Almoana, was designated back in the 2000s by the city council based on a funding plan, you know, availability of funds. And so that's why it goes from East Kapolei to Ala Moana. But when they did that, they also put in a plan to extend the system further into Kapolei in the west side, and then to UH Manoa on the east side. So those will most likely be the first two extensions to the system. I think everyone kind of understands that it needs to go further into Kapolei, the way that Kapolei is developed. And we have, 20,000-30,000 people normally a day at UH Manoa. So it's really important to connect UH Manoa.
I know the folks who are watching us on Facebook Live know that in a regular school year, about August 22nd, you know that UH Manoa is back in session.
Yeah.
And then right around May 16th, you're glorious that it's out for summer. So
it's like a little city in itself. You got students, faculty, other employees, and it's a huge activity center. And the city council back in the 2000s recognized that and saw that as a next extension, if you will.
Yeah. Little trivia for you folks. UH is actually the largest customer for Hawaiian Electric. So he's right. It is its own little city. Our next question, Facebook question.
So we got an email question from Jacob, and he's wondering, he saw that on the maps the stations seem pretty close together. Does that mean it's a quick commute between stations?
Yeah, you know what, Jacob, very good question that he emailed into us. It is pretty quick, is it not?
Right, so on average, we're talking a mile between stations. It varies a bit, and as you mentioned earlier, Jai, about 3 to 4 minutes between stations, something on that order. Most people maybe are going from one station to, let's call it an intermediate station. Average drive may be 15 minutes. You know, if you're going from the Pearl Ridge area, for example, to downtown, it may be somewhere around that. But if you're going the entire length of the system, we're talking about a 42-minute ride.
Yeah, that's quick. That's really quick. Okay, we have another question.
Shelby, via email, she asks, she notices there's a driver's seat there, and it's a driverless train. Can you talk about the seat?
So, Shelby, thank you for that. And we've talked about this a lot. This is going to be the most popular seat on this train. I kid you not.
Yeah.
Why is it here? And it's just look, folks, this is a pretty good view.
Right, so I think there's really a couple of purposes to this. It is a driverless train, so no one is normally needed at the front of the train. So purpose number one is to let that lucky person, lucky Keiki, get this seat. Maybe I'll be talking to Hitachi about adding a couple more seats here in the future. But the other reason is that if we need to drive the train in a manual operation for failure management purposes or some other purpose, the train can be driven manually. The controls are under these lock panels. And so this seat is really just there for somebody, a technician, that may have to take the train manually.
So this is going to be a really popular seat. Yeah. We appreciate your questions. Do we have another question? I'm just looking off camera real quick, and we appreciate you guys tuning in and stay tuned. We're going to be doing this every month. So we did our first one last month at the business center down in Kalihi. We're on the train for this one, and we will have one in June as well. So stay tuned for the details.
And Jun asks, he actually says, I hope it will start running this year. Can you talk a little bit about when it will start service?
A lot of people are anxious for this to get up and running, even if it is just interim service, even if it is only half of the segment. When and is it going to be happening?
Well, I share your enthusiasm for that, and people that know me know that I was pushing very hard for train operation this year. But unfortunately, the events of, related to the COVID-19 kind of got in our way and slowed us down with that goal in mind. So we've recently conferred with the Department of Transportation Services at the city, who really has the oversight responsibility for the actual operations and maintenance. And it was determined that the earliest that we can expect to open that first segment is in March of 2021. So that's unfortunate related to the virus situation. But by the end of the year, you'll be seeing trains running more frequently because we'll be going into that trial running period,
sure,
leading up to the full safety certification. So I know that'll be sort of a tease, but you know, we're all looking forward to getting this open to passenger service.
So soon, we promise soon. Thank you, June, for that. Okay,
last
question. Okay, we're told this is the last question. Again, stay tuned to our Facebook page, and you'll find out when in June we're going to have our next Rail Facts, exactly when and exactly where.
So Kristen is excited that the trains will run on electricity. Can you talk about how sustainable the system is?
It's very important these days. I've got two teenagers, and I hear that's a word that teenagers say a lot, is sustainable.
Right.
What makes this system special in that way?
Well, I think right before the virus hit, the state of Hawaii was talking about having just registered its 10,000th electric vehicle on the road. And what we're looking at, when we go into full service to Ala Moana, we're looking at over 120,000 riders a day. So something like 10 to 12 times the amount of people every day will be on electric rail transportation.
That's a big electric vehicle.
Yeah, exactly. It's going to be the biggest electric vehicle in the state. So we're very excited to contribute to sustainability that way. It's totally electric operation. And as many people know, Hawaiian Electric is moving towards full sustainability by the year 2045, correct?
Yeah.
And I believe they're already about 30% of the way to that goal. So as they become more sustainable, the rail system is in lockstep with that because it's fully electric. So that's one of the major ways to contribute to sustainability. We're also working to look at putting solar on some of our station roofs,
okay,
and the roofs of this maintenance facility here as well. Energy saving, I guess, is one of our main concerns, and working together with the city as well, because somebody has to pay the electric bill, and you know, it behooves us all to save energy as much as we can.
The Chief Executive Officer, Andrew Robbins, I'll give you a fist bump. It's a changed times,
yep,
but we appreciate our Executive Director joining us from the Honolulu Authority for Rapid Transportation. We appreciate you tuning in to our Facebook Live. As we said, next month, stay tuned. We will have one in June as well. And if you just follow us on Facebook, you will find out exactly when that's going to be. We appreciate you joining us this afternoon. Hope you have a wonderful day. And again, stay tuned because we will be having these Rail Facts on a monthly basis. All right, have a great day.
Thank you.